Welcome to Chat with Nomads, where we uncover travel insights, business advice, adventure stories, and lifestyle tips with world travelers and digital nomads. Here is your host, Rax, from nomadsunveiled.com.
Hi, guys. Welcome to another episode of Chat with Nomads. I'm feeling very positive today, I think, because of our guest. She's always smiling. We have with us today Lainey Liberty. So Lainey is an inspirational figure within the world schooling community, and she has spoken at TEDx Amsterdam about her world schooling experiences. And today she's the founder of Project World School with her son Nero. Hey Lainey, welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks for inviting me. I'm really excited to be here too. And you're right, I am always smiling. There's always something to smile about in life, right?
I always look at the photos you post on the blog and a lot of your videos. Like, you're always smiling and giving out a lot of positive energy. It's kind of influential as well. Like, when I look at it, I kind of feel happy because I'm seeing someone smiling.
I appreciate that. And every now and then I'll post a picture of me just like looking at something and I'm not smiling, and somebody will message me privately and say, something wrong? You weren't smiling in your picture.
So smiling is like a default status now, I guess. So I guess for the audience that don't know you, or for the audience that also know about you, why don't you give an introduction of yourself and your background story, so we have a context to fall back on as the conversation goes on.
Sure. So this particular podcast is really focused for nomads. And I guess that's where I'll start, is the beginning of my nomadic journey, right? Mm-hmm. That's a good place, right?
Sounds good. Yep.
Okay. So for me, my story starts in 2008. That's when my son and I made the decision to actually leave the United States and travel. We were living in California, and I owned a business. I spent the 18 years prior working in advertising, marketing, and design. And for the last 8 of those years, I owned my own agency, and it was a boutique branding agency. And it actually was doing quite well until 2008, which is when California's economy crashed. Mm-hmm. And being a single parent, and especially at the time, I was feeling so much stress and overwhelm, and I was really not managing, balancing my time between parenting and running my business. But I always thought, you know, I'm doing this for my family, for my son, and, you know, there's a reason why I'm doing all of this stuff. But I quite honestly wasn't great at managing and balancing, you know, my time. So when the economy crashed, and yet again, my son said to me, who was 9 at the time, "Mom, you're always working. You never spend any time with me." You know, heartbreaking. I just said to him, "You know what? Let's just go have an adventure. Let's sell all of our stuff and just put on some backpacks and go have an adventure together." And he's like, "Just you and me?" I was like, "Yeah." And he's like, "Do I have to go to school?" No, of course, let's just go travel for a year. He's like, "I'm in." So that was the beginning. And I mean, a lot, obviously, I'm giving you a really sort of Reader's Digest version, but it was the best thing that ever happened. And that was, 12 and a half years ago. We haven't gone back. So the 1-year trip turned into, we're still at it. You never know what can happen. So yeah, that was it. That was the beginning of the adventure. That's what started it. Lots of changes happened, you know, on the road. He was 9, just turning 10 when we set out. Mm-hmm. And he's going to be turning 22 in April. So, wow.
Time flies, right?
Yeah, time flies. And his entire childhood was spent nomadically. So, you know, we did stay in different places, but we really got to immerse ourselves in different cultures and really be present in our own lives. And so much to talk about from there, but I'll let you ask.
Yeah, sure. We are going to dive deeper for sure. Like, I have a lot of questions for you, because the concept of world schooling, it's really amazing for me. I mean, I'm still really far from implementing such a concept just because I'm not married or anything. But then the whole concept of it is just very intriguing to me because, well, I mean, gradually we are always looking at the education system around the world, and some places we always feel like the education system is simply way too focused on like academics and very theoretical stuff, whereas a lot of kids are not getting the soft skills that they really need in the real world or really helps them in the real world, right? So I actually spoke to a couple who is world schooling, a South African couple who is world schooling their kid as well, 2 years back, and I've been following their journey. And it's just very interesting and very exciting for me to see how the kid is growing, because they tend to upload videos on the social platforms. So I do see the interaction and how the kid has grown just over the last 2 years. It's just amazing how the growth pattern is, right? You mentioned you guys didn't start out with the intention to travel for like 12 years. The intention was only to just do it for a year, like a gap year, and then go back. What made you change halfway through the journey? When did it change to be the concept whereby you just went like, hey, maybe we should just keep doing this rather than going back?
So a couple of things. You know, I told you the circumstances before we left. So as we were leaving, my son and I sat down and really, really hammered out how we wanted to experience this experience. And part of the things that we came up with was we wanted to be in partnership. Right? It wasn't my decision. It wasn't his decision. We really wanted to make this a partnership trip. And that was really, really important for us. So we applied that concept and we were already pretty much practicing it. However, from a parenting perspective, I was still the authority and we lived within the conception of really, really conventional life. But this was about partnership. This was really different. Obviously, I would always be the adult, he'd always be the child in this circumstance, but the decision-making was ours to make. That meant that the budget, we would decide together how we were spending our money, where our budget would go. And then we also decided to come up with a bunch more themes that were really important to us and mostly really important to my son. My son said to me when we were living our conventional life, although we had a really close friendship or a connection relationship, he said that he was very accustomed to me saying no to so many things because, not because I wasn't letting him, but because time didn't allow. I didn't have the time. I had the resources. I had the money. I was making money. I was working. I just didn't have the time to go out and really enjoy it. So this was going to be a journey into saying yes. And boy, be careful what you set into motion, because we practiced that. We practiced saying yes. Of course, we had to balance, you know, what was safe and what was in alignment with our core values. Like we wouldn't do something that didn't align with the things that were important to us, like anything that is not in alignment. We were pretty clear about the things that we valued and wanted to see. These were conversations that we were having in our family structure all the time, but I wasn't able to say yes to adventure and to opportunities and to being, you know, spur of the moment, spontaneous. So that was really, we were stepping into this with the idea that yes was going to be a big part of our journey. And well, about 8 months into our journey, we had done a lot of sort of traversing back and forth. We stayed in some places. We, you know, did a lot of different things. And 8 months in, my son said to me, "Mom, can we just keep doing this forever?" Guess what? I had to say yes. So I did say yes. And that was the moment that I had to really shift gears and shift mindset and figure out how I can make this sustainable. And also that was the moment that I had to really address the educational portion of it. And the other thing that I wanted to comment on before you ask this question is we are always learning. And even though you stated that you were so far away, you're not even married yet, you don't have kids, you are learning. We're all learning. We have brains. That's what they're wired to do. And the fact that if we shift our mindset to acknowledging that we are all life learners, and there are many ways for us to learn. There's experiential learning. There's social learning. There's actual academic learning that extends beyond what we call the education system. And those things are constantly happening. So 8 months in, when my son said, "Can we just keep doing this?" I needed to look at the educational portion. And because we were already learning, we had learned tons about the history and the places where we were. We learned about the archaeology and the anthropology. We learned about, oh my gosh, so much stuff, the relationship to the environment and the cultures, cultural studies, art, so many different things, even science. As we looked at the way that certain cultures progressed, it was really fascinating. And looking back on the first 8 months, we were learning effortlessly because we were so engaged and present, and we were empowered to just follow what we were interested in doing and seeing and learning. So that was really a powerful epiphany. So the saying yes to keep doing it, and then the realization that learning was happening. And even though I took my son out of school and he didn't go to fifth grade, I believed, I knew like I was going to take my next breath, that this was a way better education than he would ever get in fifth grade. And I just thought, let's just continue this path, because I learned so much in those first 8 months without even trying. I learned because we were present and I was curious. And that's what my brain is wired to do. That's what your brain is wired to do. So ask questions, be present, take in new information, integrate it, give it meaning, and create connections to other things that you know. That's learning.
For sure, for sure. I definitely agree with that. And this whole concept of learning is, I guess, one of the main foundational concept of learning to me, especially as a traveler, is to really be open to many different things. And that kind of resonates with what you mean by saying yes to a lot of stuff, right? Mm-hmm. One of the key reasons for me to do this podcast is actually, well, I love talking to travelers in the first place, but I always feel like different travelers bring about very different perspective to your point of view, because a person's views are always influenced by like their social circle, by the environmental factors. And when a person is back home, you tend to hang around with people who clicks with you, right? So there's a reinforcement of the same value. And as that goes on, you kind of feel like that is the norm, of which is not true at all. Because the moment you step out and you go overseas and you speak to people from different countries, different culture, even different professions, right, you realize that what you think is the norm is actually not the norm, right? So it's really having an open mind, and traveling just helps you to do that. Like you are exposed to so many elements that it might even be opposing your inherent value. But if you have an open mind about it, you will think twice about it. You will start to think about, why does this person think this way, right? And how does it challenge my perception? And are we thinking too narrowly or too stubborn about our views that we tend to ignore other people's perception and their place, you know?
Absolutely. And in fact, that became a theme within our travels over the last 12 years. And we've given classes on this. And the exploration of worldviews is a powerful and necessary process, especially in a globalized world, right? We are, this year obviously is a little different, but we're connected. This is a global way of connecting. One of the experiences that we had that really sort of drilled home how important worldviews were was when we were in Ecuador, and we were on the coast in this little fishing village, and we had our perception of what the environment looked like, and we were running the perception through these filters of our own experience. Oh, this is very much like this coastal town. Oh, people do this like the experiences that we've had. Oh, then it must mean this. And without sort of recognizing that they're seeing it different, our worldview was then imposed on the locals in that community. But then we met teachers, and within this village, there were school children, and they were working to really integrate the beaches and the surrounding jungles as part of this rich place for the children to learn about their environment. And I would have never seen it that way. I just would have taken that for granted. And then we met the conservationists who looked at the ocean as a place to really preserve. And that was slightly different than the perception of the teachers and the villagers, right? Because now they are really concerned with the whales. That means, yet the villagers and the children were looking at some of the fables and myths around the immigrating whales. And then we met the fishermen who went out on the boats every single day and came back, took their boats right onto the beach and started, you know, gutting and cleaning and selling their fish, leaving behind tons of, you know, fish waste on the shore. And their focus and their perception was really looking at this as a way, the ocean, this whole space was a way for them to provide for their families. And not one was right. They were all coming at it from different perspectives. And then our perspective was way different because we were a tourist. And in that moment, we realized that there is no such thing as one global worldview. And the more that we were able to recognize that there is space to have different worldviews live side by side and not be threatened by one another, but could really coexist. That's our work. That's our work as travelers. That's our work as world schoolers. And that's our work as humans, is creating that space for, again, finding the bridges of connection instead of focusing on the differences and staying in dialogue.
I really love what you just said, because it summarizes the whole concept so well, in the sense that different people can be looking at the same thing, but their focus and their priorities are totally different. And when your focus is different, the way you see things, it's just different, right? And it's a matter of being able, I think a world citizen is someone who is able to really see things from different perspectives. It might not be my perspective or my focus, but now I understand why someone might see something this way, right? And this inherently brings about what we are talking about in terms of soft skills as a human being, to be able to understand other people a lot.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm not going to go down the pathway where I'm arguing with you about the value of what we call academics, because first of all, I'm not a big fan of conventional schooling. And the idea that you have to pour these academics into kids' heads is kind of lame, especially when we've got phones where we can access any of that fact or information at our fingertips. Yeah. But what I can say, which is more important, is creating the skill set to be able to solve problems. And you do that by being in the real world and looking at real world situations, research, learning how to be curious and really not be afraid of your own curiosity. And that really leads into learning resilience, the ability to, you know, going down the path this way and an obstacle happens so we can gracefully shift this way. Collaboration, cooperation, all of those things come about as something that you practice when you travel. So you call them soft skills, I call them life skills. And I think those are the most important things for us to practice, not only when our children are small, but for us adults to practice too, because most of us didn't have the opportunity to really learn those things either. So yeah.
Yep, I like that. I like that. I actually think life skills, I would agree with you that life skills is actually a way better term to put it, because ultimately, that is what's important when we go through our life, right? To really be able to become what's human, exactly. Because whereas I think a lot of people today are obviously focused on like things like careers and stuff like that. So when you break it down, there's like a hard skill and there's like a soft skill. But when we travel, we really start to realize maybe being able to interact with people and understand people, that is actually the key to life in general. You know, like anything else, like work and stuff, is just part and parcel of the things you do to survive in life. That's really interesting. I want to go back to this part before I forget, because I think it's a very interesting point to touch on. And I'm not sure if there's a deeper relation or psychological aspect to it, but I'm curious to know from your perspective, because I hear from you that you really came from a point of like being a mother throughout the journey, because one of the reasons that you started to go on this gap year per se is because you wanted to be closer to your son. I mean, yes, there was a financial crisis and all, but I think the main driving factor that I hear from you is really that Miro was saying, hey, mom, you're not spending enough time with me. And you recognize that and you went like, okay, let's do this, right? And even the decision to continue on the journey indefinitely also came from like Miro took the initiative to say, hey, mom, could we do this forever? And you're like, my kid is happy doing it. I'm going to make it happen, right? I'm sure when you started, you definitely didn't have any idea on, oh shit, how am I going to handle the education aspect and the challenges of traveling forever? But your mentality must have been like, I don't care, I'll figure it out because I can see that my son is happy doing it, right? So does this traveling aspect kind of builds the foundation of this so-called partnership relation between the two of you?
Well, it did for us. And in terms of, you know, where I was before we started traveling, I mean, I did a lot of sort of self-development work and I read so much about, you know, how to be present in your own life, but I never had the time to practice it. And it really helped me personally, my self-development, my who I stepped into as the human I was supposed to be or meant to be or wanted to be. Travel for me was that vehicle I got to really express a person who was present and really in touch with self. And I realized that travel for me and world schooling with my son was that gift, right? So it wasn't my intention, but I'm glad that it developed that way. I can't even imagine who my son would be had we not left or who I would become had we not left. I really love being in this world and I love having this amazing classroom, which is the world, to reflect to us in the outer worlds how we are experiencing the inner worlds. And I never knew that relationship before. I never knew that the world, both the inner and the outer worlds, were so rich. And in fact, I was so focused on the outer world before and my position and my status and my bank account, you know, that I forgot about the richness of the inner worlds. And so, you know, in terms of balancing, I got to rebalance those scales quite a bit. Part of my saying yes was because I was seeing how different life really was. And it didn't have to be filled with the stress of getting ahead and the just, well, can we just say stress? I have to be filled with that. And there was so much joy. And then the other thing that I realized was I had almost missed out on the first 10 years of my son's childhood because of my addiction to being busy. Mm-hmm. I didn't want that anymore. I didn't want that. And I didn't want that so deeply at any cost that I was willing to cherish however much time I had left of my son's childhood with me, because soon I'd be growing an adult, right? I'd be growing this adult and he'd be off leading his own life. And what an honor it was or is to be a parent. What a great joy it is to be a parent. And I really wanted to have that experience. So, yeah. And I did hear from some of my professional friends, Lainey, you're committing, you know, professional suicide. But again, I finally was able to balance what was important to me.
I guess the whole point about when you said internal and external is really that most of the time we are so caught up in the external life of the hustle and bustle of life, we kind of lose track of certain things internally that, and it's very unconscious and subconscious, right? You don't realize it. It's only really when you take a step back and you look into it, then you will start to realize, hey, maybe time just flew by and I just committed all my time to all this work stuff and chasing status and stuff like that, that I have never really reached out into my own heart to look at, you know, the feelings and the things inside that really matters in life.
Yeah, exactly what you just said.
I love it. I definitely like your point of view and share the same perspective about it, because I'm guilty of it sometimes myself as well. You know, you get too engrossed and stuff. And sometimes if you look at what your other friends are doing, probably back home, or most of what your friends are doing, you'll be thinking about it. You're like, they are chasing after all these things, and then maybe I should also do a bit of this. But it's all about balancing both sides of the coin, I guess. I think we have quite easily touched on the pros of world schooling. I think we just got into it. It was so obvious. So, but I'm sure there are some challenges about it as well, right? On like world schooling a kid, especially when you just started out and maybe not even sure how to do it. So what are some of the challenges that you have faced along the way?
Our biggest work as parents is if we are moving from one style of life into another style of life is what we call in the education world, deschooling, what we call in self-development, unpacking, right? Mm-hmm. We are looking at these belief systems that are so ingrained in us that are the voices of doubt that come up. But what did you learn today? But my child will never go to university. Oh, you're ruining your kid's life. Like, those are not my voice, but those messages do play in our head. And when those things are playing in our head, we've got a couple of things that we have to do. Number one, we've got to stop and hear what's being said, right? If we want to do the work to go figure out where they come from, we could do that. But really, it's about challenging and shifting these beliefs, which are limiting and not serving us. So when you find yourself as a parent saying, but you need, we're not going to do schoolwork, but you need to do math and 1 hour of reading. Okay, I understand that you have a belief system about what your child should be doing. But what would happen if you trusted the experience of learning naturally without putting these arbitrary rules that come from somebody else's voice or idea into the relationship? And so for me, sort of learning how to acknowledge that when those thoughts came up, learn how to listen that they were playing, just watch them, also choosing to reprogram them. And then with my relationship with my son or within my family, any family can do this, choosing not to put arbitrary rules and control into the relationship. And those things really shifted how I lived, right? We decided early on to be in partnership. Well, partners don't give, you know, an hour of math homework to their partner. Like, would you do that to your girlfriend or boyfriend? Like, you just don't do that. So if the concern is that I want you to understand math because my belief is that these things are important, then let's get together and do our budgeting. Let's figure out how we can project how much money we'll have or need for this thing. Let's translate the money into a different currency. Let's figure out how long it takes on a train to get from this place to that place. Because it's in context, right? It's not this arbitrary thing. If math is that important thing, right, in your brain. So there are ways of creating these things in context without imposing a rule on your child to learn that, but also stepping back and being in partnership and in dialogue and really sort of processing what's going on in those inner worlds, right? Because the outer world looks, you know, you'll see the thunder and the lightning and the rain when that's what you're feeling in the inner worlds. If it's thundering and lightning and rain in the outer worlds and inside you're feeling joyous, then you look at that as a beautiful time to go out in the rain barefoot and dance. Like, it's the same situation, but how are we going to process that together?
That's super duper cool, because I know what I have seen what you are saying play out, because I went into all these world schooling groups and a lot of comments were parents having that dilemma occasionally or maybe even regularly on like the inner voice saying, am I ruining my child's life? Is this going to be the right way to educate him? What if he does this for 5 years and he turns out like to be like not the person that you know that I anticipate, and then I kind of spoil his life because I brought him all around the world going to all these places? But you have really touched on, I guess one of the main points is being conscious to catching these thoughts. When you are feeling it, you are feeling it, right? So that's probably like the first step, to identify and be aware that you are having the thoughts. And then whenever you catch it, try and remedy it by putting in like positive thoughts and having confidence in really believing in the flow to be able to turn out well. But do you actually follow a certain curriculum or totally not? Like you just make things up as it goes. You look at the environment and there's an opportunity to probably impart like a certain skill or impart like a certain mentality, and you just take advantage of it whenever it happens.
Well, okay, so my son is now 22, so so it's slightly different, or 21. Yeah, he'll be 22 soon. It's slightly different now, but going into, we never used any curriculum at all. So different people world school and approach the education portion differently. And there are many different ways to world school as there are people. We took an unschooling approach, which means we didn't separate life from learning. So that invited me again to, you know, really actualize and step into my natural curiosity and really engage in the world around me. And I was always curious. I still am always curious. I'm always looking at something or reading something or watching something or listening to something. I'm always really curious, like, why does that tree outside my window have those little spikes? What does it mean? And why are the seed, you know, turning into what looks like cotton now? It's just really bizarre. And so that actual question led me into researching. So I understood, you know, why that tree looks like that tree and why it turns into cotton and, you know, all that stuff. Again, I don't have to learn that in a class, but when the curiosity comes up, I've got this device to actually seek out those answers. And by me modeling this natural curiosity also invites my son to tap into his own ability to ask and answer questions. So did we follow a curriculum? Not at all. That wasn't our choice. Some families, like I said, do, because that's what's important to them.
No, that's actually really insightful, because I've seen Miro speak at certain events and he's like really well spoken. He's probably more fluent than me, actually. So I speak and then I was like, are you sure this kid is like 16 or something back then? I was like, he's so confident as well, you know, like he projects himself in like a very refined manner, right? He's just pretty amazing, to be honest. I look at it and I'm like,
wow. I think so too. Nobody would accuse him of being uneducated, even though he didn't go to school, right? So that's the point.
Yep. And I like to add on to what you were just saying, because you were saying the matter of unschooling is mixing learning and living, but actually for you guys it's not just that, right? It's learning, living and work, because you guys started Project World School, and I definitely like to hear a lot more about it. But from what I kind of know, you guys actually started it out of your own needs, right? You saw a need for it because you wanted, we don't want to just be doing this alone. And I guess social challenges is actually one of the biggest issue I seem to see my friends facing, as in like when their kids meet a certain kid and they make new friends, but you know that you are going to leave or they are going to leave if they are also another world schooling family, right? And so there's always this issue of always having to make friends and leave friends. And to be honest, that's not even just a challenge faced by kids. It's a challenge faced by us travelers as well, right? Like I know that building relationship is a challenge for many traveling nomads as well. Like we can't seem to build like a long lasting relationship with anyone, right? So tell us a bit more about Project World School and, you know, how do you guys mix work, living and learning?
In terms of how we started Project World School, when my son hit 14, he really was struggling with what he perceived as isolation and not having a social network. And that really coincides with the time of the brain really shifting from most of the social learning from the family unit to a friend unit. I mean, that's what the brain is wired to do. That's what adolescence is about. That's why friends are so important during adolescence. And we had a really deep heart to heart at that time. Like, what do you want to do? You like this lifestyle. Do you want to stop? Do you want to go back to the United States and find a community? And, you know, is this something that you want to do? And he didn't want to do that. And so I said, why don't we just bring people to us then? And so that was the birth of Project World School. I learned everything I could about adolescent development, hosting communities, learning communities, travel, how to structure retreats, planning all that stuff. I didn't know. I just was, okay, I'm going to learn. I'm just going to do it. And so I did it. And the first year we got a couple of kids and it was kind of hard and we made some mistakes and we, you know, revised, improved upon that. And each year we added more and more retreats. And this actually then developed into our main income stream. And up until 2020, we were doing about anywhere from 4 to 6 retreats a year. And that's anywhere from 2 to almost 4 week retreats. And I loved it. I love working with teens. I love, you know, really helping and creating space for them to process the inner worlds because, you know, let's face it, we had just spent all this time doing this and now I wanted to facilitate this. And I realized that it was such an incredible opportunity for teens to step into their power too, because I'm working in partnership with my son. I extended that as the foundation of the teen retreats. And together my son and I really sort of came up with a structure and an ideology that really, really worked for us. So that's what we did. We brought teens around the world, lived in community. We've been to Ecuador, to Mexico, to Peru, to Japan, to South Africa, to Wales, to Thailand, all over, right? We've done these incredible trips. And I realized that this is the work that I love doing. I love working with teens. So that was a big part of the business creation on that side. But then we started getting asked by parents, like, we want to do it too. We want to do it too. And so instead of hosting retreats, we started about 6 years ago to organizing conferences. And they were basically hubs where all the world schoolers that are out there traveling could come together twice a year in different places because the parents needed community and the younger kids needed community. And so we launched Project World School Family Summits. And those met in the spring in Mexico. And then in the fall, we would alternate between a location in Asia and Europe. And many families came to all of them, right? So yeah, it just, the whole foundation of community coming together, learning and sharing, it just was such a powerful part of our lives.
Yeah, I think 2020 affected a lot of businesses, especially event-based businesses, right?
Yeah. Well, what we started to do is last year I launched a company where I've been working with teens online. So I've been teaching them, you know, during these 12-week courses, tools for self-improvement, for processing their inner worlds, for managing stress and anxiety, for really unpacking some of those big feelings that they're having, and all in congruent with their brain development. Because I had the 8 previous years living and working with teens, I really knew what they were facing right now. So that launched this year, and my son is co-teaching the younger group with me. So we're still working together, but we're doing it online now with teens and tweens. And then I launched another project with another dear friend of mine working with parents, because these are not necessarily for world schoolers. World schooling parents, I really honed in on how to facilitate ways of defining and designing a family culture that works for world schooling parents. And I taught that at all of the summits, all of the conferences that I hosted. And the feedback that I got from the families that were traveling was like, we would have killed each other had we not had these strategies and tools. But now, families that had never spent so much time together are now working from home. Their kids are doing school from home. So the company that I recently launched with my dear friend, world schooling mom, Sarah, is to teach these skills to any parent who's interested in partnership parenting now in their home. So I'm taking what I've learned and sort of adapting it for pandemic times.
Yeah, that's nice. I do see a lot of businesses definitely pivoting during the pandemic just because there's no choice, right? You still have to find other ways to survive. But in general, your whole business per se, actually sharing knowledge, right? Like you have the experiences of being through 12 years of world schooling, and you have the experiences both on the parenting side and on the child side, right? And that's really valuable for a lot of people who is looking to start, or like a lot of parents who are in doubt about, you know, what's going on, just because it's a life problem. You know what I mean? Like wondering if you are teaching your kids correctly, or the kids feeling isolated. All these are actually really closely tied to lifestyle, right? And that's like a big thing to really be soft, right? To get affirmation from others who have experience, to maybe, like you say, there are actually different methods of teaching and different methods of handling different kids, because everyone is unique. Being able to really talk to different parents on their experiences makes it very valuable as a starting point, even to get trying different methods to see what works and maybe what doesn't work in the relationship. And I know you're also not a stranger to using digital, because I know you actually started building groups online and then forming them into these real world communities, right? So how do you go about doing that? Because I think, especially with the prevalence of technology, I think gradually it will be a lot more of group gatherings, particularly now it's like pandemic time. So everything is like online first, but then actually transiting it ultimately to real world communities, because that's important in the area you're working in, right? Because it's a lot about human interaction and touch.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm not sure how to answer that going forward. I do know, though, like you said, there is so much value in connecting in real life. And I really think we need to look at this past year as, okay, so here's one extreme, and let's glean everything we can to learn from that experience, but recognize that human connection is just so incredibly important. Last year, when the pandemic first hit, I was in, well, I'm still in Mexico for our Project World School Family Summit in March. And then everything just started getting shut down. And I immediately went into, how can I support my community right now? And so I brought we would do women's circles at the summits, where it would just be a very sacred space for the moms of the group to be seen, be heard, and speak their truth and really connect. So I started bringing that free online to the women in our world schooling community. And I hosted every week until December, a weekly women's circle for free, just so I can make sure that they have that safe space. My son and I also started hosting for free teen meetups every week, and then a second age group for the tweens. So we would make sure that we have this safe space for teens and tweens to come and just connect with their friends and meet new friends and be social around the world. And we play games where I'm really good at moderating werewolf. It's just so much fun. We have a blast. So my commitment to World Schoolers has been about serving and providing value. By the way, I'm still doing the teen and tween meetups, and another couple women took over the women's circle because, you know, it's really about the conversations that we're having among all of these age groups. Is I can't wait to get back together and go on trips and hug people and be together. So I'm not losing hope. I'm making sure that not trying to balance what's safe, when's the right time to do it. I think we might be having a Project World School Family Summit here in Mexico in June, actually. We'll see. As long as it's safe, we're doing it.
I mean, emotional support during the pandemic times is obviously important, right? It's not just for world schoolers. You just want to have some human interaction at least and talk about it. So I guess that's where there's interest in it as well, right? I like to talk about the philosophy of service because I feel like I kind of get a vibe that service is a big pillar.
Well, absolutely. It's part of my core values. I worked, as I mentioned in the very beginning of this conversation, I worked in advertising, and there was something, I hate to say this, and I'm sorry if there's advertisers listening to it, something soul-sucking about creating consumerism that got me so off balance to what my natural gifts are. And I really felt like, okay, I'm not going to look for purpose and meaning in my own life through the outer worlds anymore. What lights me up? What really lights me up? And I'm really on my path. I'm on purpose when I'm supporting other people. For me, the big balance, though, is how to make sure that giving of myself and feeding myself at the same time. So 2020, you know, there was a whole lot of giving, making sure everybody was okay. But at the point where I realized that my business was not going to start again in 2020, Project World School, taking teens on trips. We canceled every trip that we had on the books. I needed then to take a little step back and go, okay, how can I be of service and now fold this into my work? I could easily go back into consulting and branding and web design and advertising, but it doesn't light me up. And it doesn't feel like I'm of service to the world. I'm not creating any sort of shining lights, you know, for people. I'm not helping people. And that really is one of my core values.
I definitely see the passion oozing from you when you're talking about world schooling. And then when you start talking about advertising, your energy goes way lower. You're like, yeah, that's really interesting. So I'm sure like you are. It's actually a very interesting topic because just before this, I was talking to another guest also about between passion as well as you have to do something you like, you love. You also need to have a bit of the practical sense to make sure that you're not like selling off yourself and you still are able to survive, right? I mean, you got to take care of yourself before you can take care of other people as well. For a lot of world schooling parents, let's say they want to kind of be able to generate certain income to be able to carry on a world schooling lifestyle, what are certain tips or certain directions that you would say if someone just wants to get started today? But I guess a lot of people that wants to get started, the first question is, I don't know where to start.
Well, that's a big one. I would find support. around the whole location independent business thing. That's not my expertise. I don't talk about that because I only know what my path is. But I have met some brilliant people who support people to create businesses that are location independent. Where I come in, I would say really work on, dedicate some time to really defining what education means to you, what those expectations are, define how you wish to experience your family culture, how do you wish to engage, how do you wish to make decisions, what is the traditions and rituals you wish to experience, what are those things, work on really defining and designing your family culture, and then find some tools that you can use to help you process some of these limiting beliefs. Know your triggers, like spend some time on those inner worlds as well. Because when you start getting those things in order, those are not going to interfere with the outer worlds, right? And the outer world is really what we're talking about with world schooling. So I hope that that's useful.
Yeah, I think that's quite insightful. And based off that, I think the underlying theme is that a lot of parents will actually face quite a bit of challenges along the way for sure. And you have worked with many parents. What are some of the more common challenges or problems that you think most parents would face just when we're schooling? Like we talk about the bigger ones, which is the doubt about whether I'm doing this right for my kids, right? But are there also other problems that will come in along the way that you see being very commonly shared by other world schooling parents?
The biggest issue is expectations and agenda. And we have to watch it when us as parents who believe we have the authority to set our agendas on the family. And if the family, members of the family are not in alignment with the same goals, you are setting yourself up as a parent and as a human being for disappointment. If you're in reaction mode to these triggers now, you're not going to create a joyous experience. So, you know, there's that. So watch your judgments, your agendas, but also creating the ability to really be in dialogue with everybody in the family and make sure everybody's needs are heard, make sure they're seen and understood, and make sure that everybody is on board. Because if you're just dragging somebody along, that's not going to work. So first, you'll have a miserable time. I guarantee you, you'll have a miserable time. If you are forcing a child to do this because they don't want to do it, it won't be fun for anybody. I'm all about, let's hear the objection and then discover what is the unmet need underneath that. And if it's because your child's resonating in fear that they're going to miss out, then start creating solutions as a family to hear those needs and actually meet those needs. You know, okay, so really you don't want to go because you don't want to leave your best friend. Well, let's do this. Maybe you could have the best friend come with us for 2 weeks every 6 months. Like, I could pay for that. Like, how great would that be if I'm taking my kid out? Let's work on that. And then we've got this balance where everybody's needs are being met. It doesn't mean everybody's needs are going to be met all the time, but there's got to be that safe space where everybody's seen and heard, or else why would you want to do it?
For sure. I think that's interesting, because do you think in that case that usually a world schooling family actually are able to address, because I know that in a normal family there's bound to be conflict and stuff, right? And sometimes we don't bother to address it just because we don't see each other 24/7, and most of the time you go to work for at least half the day, you don't see each other, and you just live with the so-called problem that exists because you are too lazy or you can't be bothered to fix it. But whereas in terms of world schooling, you kind of hang around each other for like almost all the time, right? And this kind of dialogue kind of comes up because it's important to address it right away rather than say, I'll keep it and then it might stack up more and more and then blow up one day, right? Do you think that's actually one of the, because just from an outsider point of view, hearing what you're talking about, I'm seeing a whole lot more communication aspects to different members of the family.
Absolutely. I think in terms of priorities and conventional families, conventional lifestyles, like that is so low on the scale because all of the other priorities are more in the forefront. You know, I've got work, I've got work, I've got school, I've got, you know, schedules and obligations and bills and lights and food and cooking and like all this other stuff, right? And so we don't prioritize really the family culture. But when you're traveling, that's all you got, right? You know, that is the security. I remember somebody asking Miro when he was about 17 and like tears streaming down my eyes when I overheard his answer. But the question somebody asked him was, you don't have any security because your mom's been dragging you around the world. And he said, oh, I have more security than most families because I've got my mom. And that,
wow.
So the priorities and the mindset shifts quite a bit. And let's face it, not everybody prioritizes their family. That's okay. Maybe these are not the families I'm talking to, right?
Yep.
But those that want to actually, they're world schooling so they could spend more time with their children. They like their children. They really want to give their children the world. Basically, those are the families that need some of these tools to really shift from conventional way of living to a way of living that's really outside of the norm. And we need tools. We need tools. We need to be able to know how to deal with each other's triggers and unpack these big topics and create safe spaces for all of us to be seen and heard and to really honor one another as autonomous beings. Like,
Yep. I guess you really hit the nail on the head because that sounds amazing just in terms of like improving family dynamics. And I definitely agree with what you say about like, different people have their different priorities. It might not necessarily be that, you know, I want to do family first or everything like that. And that's fine because everyone has, again, back to the topic of everyone having different opinions about stuff and whatever makes you happy, right? Like, if that's right, the way you want to live, just make sure you're happy with it. I think that's already a very great start. Cool. Thanks, Lainey, for coming on today. I think there's a lot of insights that you just shared, but I really, really like the whole point about learning, and it's just so amazing for the fact that I didn't even try to dive into that at the start and it just went straight to that. And I love the concept so much because I always tell people, for example, for this podcast, I can say that, hey, I'm doing my guest is a world schooler, right? So yes, we're going to talk about world schooling. Yes, we're going to talk about some business tips about building communities and stuff like that. But I always say one of the main reasons that I do this is actually the diversity in the different guests that comes on. And the real takeaway is to really understand there is different ways to approach a life that will make you happy. And everyone does it in a totally different way, right? Like, I might not be doing world schooling now, but I hear what you say and I learn so much. And I know certain concepts are applicable even to my current life, like how to do more communications and how to really reach insight and be more conscious about your thoughts. And all these are just super valuable, even though it's not related directly to world schooling. You can deploy the same concept across multiple areas of life. Yeah. So that is, I think that's the gem, right? Like that really covers the whole perspective of it.
Wonderful. Thank you. I really enjoyed this conversation.
Yeah, me too. Like, thank you so much.
Thank you for listening to Chat with Nomads. Please remember to subscribe and leave a review wherever you listen to your podcasts. And be sure to share with your friends. Also, we'd love to know what topics you'd like to hear more about. To stay updated on the latest, join us on our mailing list at chatwithnomads.com. You can also find more travel and nomading tips at Nomads Unveiled. That's NOMADSUNVEILED.com. Start living your dreams today. We'll catch you in the next episode.